We now have another inspirational speaker telling another inspirational story, and again, a man with a varied background. He started off in KPMG as an accountant. He went to Nickelodeon. I would have thought that was much more interesting. As a television station in the finance area, ended up as deputy CEO and left to start off his own, or to fulfill his own dream, start off his own company. And within the space of about 8 years, it's got sales of 150 million in about 20 countries. It is a fantastic story which would be directly relevant to everybody in the audience. Paul Lindley, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Now, I'm very aware I'm the third guy on, and it's been a long day for everyone at work, so I'm really glad when I realized I was the third on that I've not packed my presentation with charts and words and things, just a lot of pictures, really. And it's because I think meaningful marketing is a very personal thing, and it's a very human sort of thing, marketing. And I'm just going to tell a story. I'm going to tell my story of Ella's Kitchen and hope that there are things in that that just are for you people that are not accountants, the trained marketeers, just pick up as that's what marketing's about. I hope you'll notice as we go through that the marketing I'm going to talk about is marketing internally and all about our culture, and that's where it starts, and our marketing externally to our consumers and the people who keep us in business. But I'll start with just saying how delighted I am to be here. Delighted because Ireland's such an important market for Ella's Kitchen. We sell a lot here, but we also make a number of our ranges with Irish manufacturers too. And it's important because you're also important within that whole chain of things. But I'm half Irish. My mum's Irish. I grew up with grandparents, Irish grandparents, who insisted on food being the center of the house and good meals and good drink. And I know how important food is to this economy and this culture. So integrating Ella's Kitchen into that whole culture is something that we've concentrated a lot on. Also like to thank our partner, our distributor, Brand Shapers, who's here in the room this evening, who's helped us understand the Irish market and make sure what we say about the Ella's Kitchen brand is relevant to an Irish family and helped us grow our business here. So marketing, I think, is all about just thinking like a toddler. And I'm going to ask you in this next 20 minutes or so, 40 minutes or so, to take off your suits and your ties and your work dresses and skirts and things, and put on instead princess dresses and astronaut suits and pirate suits, and just be a toddler and have that mentality that anything is possible. Because that's how our customers think, that's how our consumers think, and that's how we have tried to build our brand, by just thinking simply, telling stories, thinking simply about how our consumers think about things and building our brand around that. I ask you to hold on tight. I'm going to run through a whole load of slides very quickly, but they're all pictures, as we said. So hopefully you've all heard of Ella's Kitchen, and if you've got an under five-year-old, you'll have used us. But what we do is we make organic baby food and toddler's food and young children's food, and we make the best, in my opinion, that's sold in Ireland and elsewhere in that category. And it's really born from two areas, two things that came together in my life. First of all, I had my daughter, Ella, who's now unbelievably 15. But when she was a toddler, below that, when she was a baby, when we first started to try and wean her, she had all kinds of challenges that she gave us about she didn't really like food she liked in the first few weeks of life and then wouldn't try new things. And my whole things that I thought I was best at came into play because I could be silly and messy and fun and just try and make her smile to open her mouth to pop in the spoon. So I was doing that at home and I was thinking, okay, if you can give children good food but make it fun, there's something that will work in my own home. But at the same time, as John said, I was working at Nickelodeon and I could see from behind my desk the statistics that television was being put at their door, really, that in the UK and in Ireland, about a third of our kids are overweight and about 20% of them are obese, and it's getting worse. And something needs to be done about it because our societies can't cope with that. They're unsustainable. So was there a way of using all that fun stuff that I'm talking about to try and get healthy food to my own child into a business, into a brand, to try and solve a society problem and make some money along the way. So those two things came together, and I had this sort of concept of maybe if we could bring healthy, handy, and fun together. Two of those things normally work against the other thing in the food industry. And if we could bring them together, then maybe that's the thing. And I started really unusually, I've subsequently found out, so I was just an accountant trying to play to be a marketeer, but looking back, I found I had this concept of a brand without having really defined what our products would be. I knew what the brand would stand for and built products around fitting in that brand. And I think most people, when they start a business, go the other way around. They have a bunch of products and they create a brand around those products. And the three things that I thought about my brand when I was sort of handing in my notice at Nickelodeon thinking I'd give this a go are things that differentiate us today when I think about my marketing hat on, the USP still. The first is that we put kids first. And when I looked as a parent shopping for baby food, and I then looked as a startup thinking what's the competitive set, I was really surprised that everybody of our competitors targeted mum, full stop. They targeted mum because mum buys it in the store. 80-something percent of purchases of baby food is done by the mother. But kids, as anyone that's a parent here will know, influence so much of our spending behavior. They certainly influence the car we drive and the holidays we go on and the house we live in. But also, they're directly the things that they consume, like the toys that they play with and the clothes that they wear and the food that they consume, they have a direct influence, whether they're in the shopping trolley being walked down the aisles of what mum puts in her basket. So that was my Nickelodeon learning. Kids first, they can influence. They control in the UK £2 billion worth of expenditure in that economy. Second thing, I thought, you know, I'm this small startup trying to go into a category that is dominated by these multinational players and whose customers are all multinational supermarkets as well. So to stand out, to have any chance of creating any market share, we had to be innovative and different. And within the context of what the brand stood for, we innovated with that packaging. Everything was glass jars before. We innovated by mixing weird ingredients together that people hadn't done before. We've innovated in the technology behind that specific product, which is very difficult to make, and innovated in marketing. So all the way we've innovated, and still with a pretty big market share in the UK and Ireland now, we see ourselves as the challenger brand and constantly need to be innovating and stand out to be different. Because that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to create the next generation of baby food and understand what a consumer, a family living in 2014, 2015, 2016 needs because of their daily lives, and we need to innovate for that. And the third thing is this idea of creating a person-to-person brand, an emotional brand. Again, when I looked at the category, it was hugely functional. It was full of brands and products that hadn't changed for a generation because I guess they thought, if we tinker with it, people won't know that it's safe still. And if we tinker with it, we won't get the pass on from a mother to her daughter to say, feed this because this is what I fed you. And I just thought that was mad. I thought people are at their most emotional when they have their babies, and we should be using emotional cues to try and engage them in something that would be relevant to their lives. So that's what we created, the brand around My Normal Family and the experiences that we went through as we assumed other families were going that we'd hoped would buy our products. So those three things, I thought, well, we could put together a corporate video. We could put together something that shows those three things about our brand. And I thought, well, that's not the way Ella's Kitchen would do it. We'd want our consumers to tell us whether we were getting it right. And this dad put this fantastic short clip, it's a much longer clip, I've cut it down, onto YouTube, which really, when I saw it, I thought, he's got it. There's the three things that I'm trying to say. So if you could roll the tape, please, we can watch this for a second.
So, yeah, we just found something else that makes you laugh. Isn't it funny? Do we go, beefy stew? It's Ella's Kitchen.
Ooh, I've even even crashed the computer. Okay, it did go on a little bit. The dad doesn't give up for about 20 minutes. So in putting the business together and the brand together, we thought very right at the beginning, what's our mission? We need to start from a point that we can always look back to, and that's our sort of lighthouse that we always look at and is rock solid. And our mission is simply to improve kids' lives through giving them a better relationship with food. Every product, every marketing campaign, everything that we think about in terms of recruiting new people or saying anything about our business comes back to that. A very simple mission to improve kids' lives through giving them a better relationship with food. And I guess it comes to a belief system that the best businesses are about those that have profits, which you absolutely need, but also a purpose, a reason why your consumer is going to differentiate your products against others, in addition to the fact that the ingredients are superior or the processing is less or the supply chain is more audited. So we've put huge social responsibility at the heart of our business. The initial thought about why this business would work is because there are overweight kids in our society, and we should try and get them to have a better relationship with food. So I thought I could just run through the 8 or 9 years from when we started with a little journey with just a few numbers, because we started 8 years ago with two products with my daughter there on in Sainsbury's supermarkets in the UK. We can run through what's happened since then. So we had two products that day, and now we have 101 SKUs. We had one person working for Ella's Kitchen, unpaid and without just a mobile phone and nothing else. And now we've got 68 people working out of some barns in rural Oxfordshire. 9 years ago, we weren't in the market, and people spent nothing out of their wallets then. Our turnover last year was over 100 million euros. And that is really a testament to the trust that families put into our brand over a period of recession that I think took our competitors by surprise. We are in 16 countries around the world. About half of our revenues are from outside of the UK. And over the last 12 months in the UK, we had a 24% market share. In the last quarter, it was actually 27%, which made us the biggest by value market share brand in our category in the whole of the UK. From a standing start. Now, those four numbers are the place where we came on the league table of fastest growing companies in Britain in the last 4 years. So we've consistently been fast growth, and that's because we've got a model that is sustainable, which is built around the brand that I'll talk about. But our biggest number and our most important number is 1 billion. And it's the simplicity of the sort of business model, I guess, coming from an accountant that I had at the very beginning, is we are trying to get 1 billion tiny tummy touch points with our consumers, a touch point being every time a child has one of our products, by 2017. We're trying to get a billion meals, if you like, into children's systems by 2017. And it's that's the one thing we measure in our office every month. We measure that, and we are smart enough to only sell them if we make a margin, and therefore the numbers all work from that. In that intervening period, though, between then and now, a number of quick milestones I'll go through. Unbelievably, 3.5 years after launching, we were recognized as the food brand of the year in Britain, a year later in Sweden. Now, if you'd asked me if we would be the baby food brand, I think I'd be extremely delighted by that, but the food brand. And 2012, the innovative product brand of the year in Norway. So I'm just hoping that next year in Ireland we can sort of add to that to make it a four-way tie across Northern Europe. But also sort of been recognized as a leading entrepreneur. And I think it's because of the way we've put our brand into the marketplace that has disrupted the whole category. Now, 18 months ago, I actually sold all my shares in Ella's Kitchen. I'm still the chief executive and still work to deliver our mission. But when you do that, and you've built a brand that is pretty personal and which everything is centered around, you've got to be confident that you sold to the right people who understand your values, give you the right value, but also can add value to the mission that you've got. And Hain Celestial were our perfect partner. But we've now got to a point where every half a second of every day, there's someone somewhere around the world having one of our products from that standing start. So that's the sort of run through of what's happened. And I thought, okay, let's take our pirate suits and things off for a second and think seriously of why that has happened. How come we've been allowed to grow the category? How come our competitors have allowed us to take market share from them? What have we done right? And I think there's a small number of things, really. If you take away from this, from the purpose of this conversation about marketing, the quality of the products and our processing system and everything, I think there are five steps to success. The first is that we've built our brand on a values-based system. We've gone back right back to basics and thought, what was it that day when I decided to give my notice into Nickelodeon that I wanted out of this business? And how can I transfer that, codify that into a set of values that live in the company so that the next person in is the person who believes and gets that and will put that all into their job to deliver the values and the mission of our business. And when you've got a values-based business, you can have a very clear and simple mission then. You can improve kids' lives by giving them a better relationship with food, and people get that whether they're the receptionist or the sales director, because they're all part of the cogs that can help that change. And you get people with passion working for you who will work through the weekends if necessary, or will have ideas outside of their job description and be welcomed in contributing them to our company. They believe in the mission. They don't believe in all about their paycheck at the end of the day. Now, we have this little guy we call Buddy, who tries to epitomize our values. And they're unique to us, so they won't really be relevant to anybody else. But I can tell you that these five things are how we recruit people, how we bonus and promote them, how we do our marketing campaigns, how we think about new products, every single thing about what we do. So we are good to each other, like we try to ask children to be. We try to think differently, like nobody else would. We want to win, and we're business-minded. We wear suit trousers, and we're childlike. We want to have that childhood sort of optimism that anything is possible and think like a toddler. So those five things, as I say, are built into every aspect of our business. The second thing why I think we've succeeded is I think we've been more consumer-obsessed than any of our competitors. I think we've sought to understand what it's like to live as a family in Ireland or Britain or any of the markets that we're in this year and next year. What are the stresses and strains, and how can we help with them? What products aren't there that they would value either being more healthy, more convenient, or more fun than they currently get, whether they make their own food at home or they buy other products? We're consumer obsessed by not saying, okay, we've got an idea for a new product, and we'll put it to test to market. We take us one or two steps back from that and say, why don't we just observe consumer behavior? Observe what it's like for a mum shopping with a toddler and a baby on tow. What's she doing in the supermarket? What's she reading? What's she not reading? What is she thinking about the meal just tonight? Is she thinking about next Saturday's meal? When she gets home, how does she cook? What happens? Does she cook a different meal for everybody? What's bedtimes? What is it like when both parents are at home? And that flows through to finding products and then testing them and launching with interactive marketing campaigns that get feedback constantly, so that when our products are in the market and we get feedback through our customer care lines, whether that is good or bad feedback, we can feed that right back into our cycle and improve our products and our consumer experience. The third thing of any business, but I think especially an entrepreneurial business, is that you have to have this awesome, fantastic team that will shoulder the responsibilities and have and give their all for the business. And as you build it up from an idea that's in an individual's head into 68 people in the UK and a number of people in the US, you've got to have that mentality of, we've got to be one team with one goal, and we've got to know what we're about. That's one of our summer parties where we have our kids coming and we sort of get all the families together, but we have to make sure that we're all pulling in the same way, unitedly. Entrepreneurial business, any business, is hard work in this competitive environment, and we've done our fair share of that. Now, the fourth thing is really about gut feel and about the fact that when any small business starts, you've got this faith in this brand that you're putting out to the consumer, but you don't have any of the Mintel reports or the Nielsen data to back it up. You've got to go with that gut feel. And if you've got to the stage where your brand has resonated with the consumers and you can start to afford all this data, which is incredibly important data, but it's not the only thing. And if you start to get that data, don't lose your gut feel, because people that have created brands that have resonated with the consumers, the data should just back up that good gut feel. Now, the fifth thing, the last thing why I think we've been successful is we've overtly tried to be a business that has done good for society, however that those words mean. But we think, as I've alluded to before, that businesses have this social responsibility to the communities that they serve, and that that's a sort of an ethic, if you like, but it's also good business practice because we employ people from the community we serve, we sell things to the community that we serve, and we should... and we contribute to some of the problems that are in our society, and therefore we need to be part of the solution. But in being part of the solution and in part, building that into your brand, you can let your consumer constituency know that that's what you're about, and that engenders trust. I've just got a couple of examples here of things that we've done along the way that we try and say is about adding back to the community. So this Christmas, with Tesco in both the UK and the US, in Ireland, we have this unique product, Christmas dinner, that every cent or every penny that we make in profit from that, we're sending to Kids Company, which is a charity in London for kids over Christmas that otherwise wouldn't have Christmas dinner. And we thought that that's okay, that's something that we want to do. We can create this, we can test it with one retailer, we can roll it out next year, and it may or may not work. I think it will connect with our consumers. What was surprised me is how it connected with our supply chain. And all of our supply partners wanted to be part of this and wanted to contribute and help with the margins and the to be able to maximize the impact that we could make. So, being good for society has impacted our supply chain and made it a collaboration together so we can maximize the impact of this product that we're trying to sell through to Christmas. Another thing that we've done is called Start Smart, and it's a pilot, an experiment, if you like, about the problems that we've got with childhood hunger and childhood obesity, specifically in the UK, by taking one city, Leicester, and trying to create a collaboration between everyone that lives or is involved with Leicester, every aspect of our society. So trying to take a business leading, and we've got, I think we had 18 other businesses that collaborated with us, from a big supermarket to one of our competitors and lots of people in the food industry in between. We collaborated with Leicester government, so the government arm. We collaborated with charities, communities, and the media to try and do things in Leicester over a month that were different and that might resonate with the people of Leicester to make them think a little bit differently about their children's food, and to take the outcome from that and go to central government and lobby for the changes to the manifesto of our parties for the general election next year. And it all worked, without going into the detail. There's stuff on our websites about all of this. But what it has shown, and what we've got kudos from in the press and in the political circles, is that it's a small business that has started this to show that we've partially created, as part of the food industry, this problem with childhood hunger and childhood obesity, and we need to be part of the solution. We're prepared to take a stance and use some of our otherwise profits to build our brand through doing this good. And then a third thing that we've just done actually last week is something called Hungry Childhoods, where again we work with a charity to actually show that although Britain has got the sixth biggest economy in the world and it's as big as it's ever been in terms of GDP, and it's growing faster than any European economy, we still have hungry children in the streets of London and elsewhere, and that's, you know, pretty disgusting really. And how can business trigger something, and our brand trigger something to raise that awareness. So because we're kids first, we get a lot of kids who are hungry, permanently hungry, to do art about it, what it feels like to be hungry. We've sponsored that. We've sponsored academic research behind that with thick papers that prove or that show what it does feel like. But and we've got this exhibition that's going around the country that you know, the kids that are obviously hungry would never buy Ella's Kitchen, and their families would never buy it. But our brand fits into it, this exercise fits because it's part of improving children's lives and increasing their relationship with food. So three things there that, being now part of a public company, having sold my business, as I said, our owners, our partners, Hain Celestial, you know, are really comfortable because it's a core part of what our brand is about. All of those things mean that we can punch above our weight. We, as 68 little people in the middle of a multinational sort of sector, can really punch above our weights with our customers, with our retail partners, with the press and everybody else. So we've thought about being an adult for long enough, I think. There's five solid reasons there why our brand has worked. Let's think about it from a toddler's point of view. And really trying to keep things simple. What have been our success steps? Well, first of all, let's look at the idea of never giving up. When you've got a brand and you're trying to create impact with that brand and people to actually recognize it, it's really, really difficult. When you're trying to do a new product that nobody's done before and attach it to a new brand, it's even more hard. But if you think about it, why would you give up when every one of us in the room that's trying to do this, and every one of us in this room today, was once a baby and couldn't walk, and now an adult and can walk, and we fell over 500 times, and we cut our knees and lips and cried and everything, but we never gave up, and we learnt how to walk. And when you're a small business especially, and you're trying to cut through with a brand that nobody's ever heard of, you cannot give up if you're onto something, and that's easier said than done. Well, we can take inspiration from toddlers from that. Likewise, the creativity that toddlers have is pretty unbounded. They believe that they could build a Lego thing upside down with the point of a pyramid on the bottom because they don't know the consequences of that it might not stand up, and maybe one in 1,000 times they'll work out of standing it up. Maybe when you put a toddler in this room and you ask them to go and find a piece of biscuit or something at the back of the room, they'll be creative and work out loads of different ways of how they're going to get that a biscuit. So we try to take some of that creativity when we do our focus groups and I'm just watching toddlers take inspiration from what they do. A third thing is about getting noticed. In this world where every supermarket has over 10,000 SKUs and every family, you know, cooks about 8 meals a year, different meals, and maybe buys 250 different products a year. So you've got to get noticed. And small businesses have no money to get noticed, so you've got to do things that make noise. And in a world now which is much more egalitarian and democratic in the business sense, where you've got social media that the best social media gets through, not the most expensive social media gets through, that's a great way to get noticed. But make a brand that's different and stand out is something that we've learned from toddlers. Likewise, toddlers haven't learned to lie yet. It's fascinating seeing, say, a 2-year-old and a 5-year-old, and both of them have stolen some chocolate cake, and you ask them both if they took the chocolate cake, and the 2-year-old will say yes, and the 5-year-old with chocolate around their mouth will absolutely deny it because they've learned the dark art of lying. And the toddlers haven't. But in a world where brands need to stand up to transparency and your staff and your team are working with you because they believe in what you're doing, when you deviate from that, you're found out. And so first, don't deviate. And if you find you have deviated, be honest about it. Be honest with your customers if the supply chain is not working and you're going to be late in delivery, and with your customers if you've let them down in some way. And you've got to be honest and empathetic with them. But that's something we can absolutely learn from toddlers. And my belief is that the businesses that have the best brands in the future will be those that have the most transparency and honesty in what they're doing. And that will generally be around the sort of more feminine, traditional feminine sort of values of compassion and communication and empathy and those sort of things built into your brand. Okay, we always find from toddlers how they're feeling. Just they wear their heart on their sleeve, and you know whether they're happy, sad, angry, or tired. And I think the best brands can show their feelings in a corporate way. I think the best managers and the best cultures are the ones where feelings are expressed and you know exactly where people stand. You ask a toddler a question, they will give you a straight answer, whether it's a socially acceptable answer in the way they put it or not. Yet when we communicate, whether that's through a brand and what you're saying in your marketing, or it's a one-on-one with your team and your internal culture, we couch it in trying not to offend and trying to get round a problem and get them to guess what the problem is rather than tell them straight. It doesn't work, and toddlers know that doesn't work, and they're kind of straight up, and best brands work where their feelings are shown. Toddlers use different strategies. I've just alluded with the biscuit at the back of the hall. And they'll work out different strategies. And any business in this competitive world, any brand in different markets or trying to attract different consumer groups needs to have a different strategy for each individual market. Now, we constantly tell kids to play nicely with each other, and they generally do. But, you know, the fact that the best brands are those that involve the whole team in their development, but can collaborate with other partners to build both partners' sort of brands up, I think are the ones that will win, and we learn that from toddlers. Likewise, you know, toddlers just do stuff. And, you know, it's so easy to get mixed up in the data saying this, but I think this, and then the second piece of data saying something else. And if you don't do anything, you kind of get analysis and paralysis. We've just taken the view of, let's try new products. We're not 100% sure they work. It feels as though they will work, and some don't work. But we learn things along the way. So we think we should more often show and do stuff, don't say we're going to do things. Toddlers dive right in. They don't understand the consequences of some things. So you know, if you don't get in quickly with a great idea, someone else is probably going to find that idea and do it quicker and cheaper and better. So just try it. Do a trial. Don't buy tons of data. Go to two stores and persuade them to list your products and see real life purchasing decisions rather than intentions in focus groups. Get straight in. But most of all, toddlers have fun. You know, it's great to be a toddler, and I think business the best businesses are those that where the employees enjoy working, and that infection can go through into the brand that they're trying to portray. So I, concluding the story, you know, I'm somebody that is inspired by people, sayings, things. That's what gives me sparks of new ideas. And I've got three or four people here that have inspired me on my journey and inspired the Alice Kitchen team to take these things forward that are part of the story. So the first one is this little guy, who's not unlike the first guy. And if you could roll the tape, we'll see what he has to say. There's nothing more rewarding than something like that, and being inspired that actually your work is getting through, and that child is having a better relationship with food because they're finding food fun. And it's just simple organic strawberries and apples in that case. And then I'm inspired by this sort of stuff, which people post on Facebook. So somebody has dressed their child in one of our products randomly because they absolutely believe in what we're saying. So this little guy is 100% squirm and 5% patience and all the way through, and written those things as we'd write them on the back of our pouches. So when you get your consumers telling you, mirroring you of what you've been trying to say, you know that your brand has cut through. So a bit more seriously, you've got Robert Kennedy here from the 60s, who I really thought about when everyone told me I shouldn't set up Alice Kitchen because all the big guys are going to squash us and the retailers won't listen. And he once said that some men see things as they are and ask why. I dream things that never were and ask why not. And that is any innovation should come through like that. You know, everyone said that a pouch was a ridiculous thing for baby food because you can't see the product. People won't trust it. And they've never used it in that scenario before. And I thought, well, why not? And I tested and we watched people using them in a store that we persuaded to carry it, and they did. So he was right. Okay, this guy is a musician called Macklemore. He's a rap artist. And he's just got this fantastic song called Make the Money. And he says, make the money, don't let the money make you. And I think when we're in business, we don't want to become the person that's just chasing the euro or the dollar all the time. We want to create a long-term brand that reinvests some of the money that we make and keeps true to the value why we set up that brand in the first place and why our consumers believe in our brand. So don't be all about the money. Make the money, that's vital, make the profits, but also make the things that your brand stands for and make sure that they remain true. Because if your consumer doesn't believe them anymore, they won't buy you. My favorite entrepreneur is Anita Roddick, who once said, if you think you're too small to have an impact, try going to bed with a mosquito. And we were that mosquito for many years. We've made our market share impact and cut through. But my favorite piece of inspiration is from my other child, Paddy, who when we were developing the first two products for Ella's Kitchen, we were sitting around the kitchen table and we had all sorts of smoothies mixed up with all different flavors, and I asked all the kids which one they preferred, and he said, I like the red one because red's my favorite color and fire engine's my favorite things, and you can hold your breath and do a big slurp and it's yummy. And that's the adultized version of the randomness that came out. But because that was a four-year-old and he's our core consumer at that stage, we just thought, that's the product. And we called it the red one, not the strawberry and banana and all the other names that we were thinking about. Our consumer had told us that it was the red one. And now, you know, it's easy for, well, it's just amazing when we hear people in the supermarket or on the train, asking for the red one or the yellow one or the green one or whatever. It's one of the reasons our brand has worked. So thank you for holding on tight. Ireland is so important to us that I'm delighted to have had the opportunity to tell the Ella's Kitchen story and to create a range of products that are so obviously Irish. Thank you very much.